As the ushers are coming and passing the baskets, I know we watched it last week, but some of you may not have been here. I want us to watch the camp video one more time.
Sometimes you gotta stare down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise.
Video again, because this church invested a lot of money and a lot of time in sending our young people to a camp, and too quickly we can forget all that God did. So we came back, Pastor Chris covered Father's Day so excellently last week, but I just wanted to take a Sunday and talk about some of the things that God did at camp and some of the things he's going to be doing here. So we're just going to take a little time to talk about this, because the title of the message today is this: it's for the youth. It's for the youth. How many of you parents would agree that you would be willing to sacrifice for your kids? Anybody? Have you ever seen your kids walk through something hard and you just wish you could take it from them? Bloop. I wish I could take the drama. Bloop. I wish I was sick and not you. Bloop. I wish I was struggling and not you. We see our kids struggle. And as a parent, we want to go in and take it from them. But we also know as parents, it's in the struggle that our kids grow. It's in the struggle that our kids learn who they are and really who God is. Now, how many of you have ever seen God come through for your children? You're watching him struggle. You're watching him struggle. Then they have that aha moment. Or then there's the victory and they look at you and say, Dad, you were right. God does see me. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like it. And I believe that we as a church are being called to open our eyes to a community around us of young people that do not have godly influences like they need. They do not have a foundation upon which to stand. They're being tossed about by every wind and wave of doctrine and by the culture in which we live. And there has to be a people that stand and say, we will create a safe place for you. We will create a safe haven away from the world's pressure for you to discover who God is, for you to discover the God of the Bible, for you to learn about him and encounter him in a personal way, and for you to discover your identity in him. Doesn't that sound amazing? But you know what? It's going to take a lot of work. Everybody say work. The work that it takes for a church to create a safe place is immense. The first battle and the most important battle is a battle that each one of us can fight at home on our knees as we pray for the next generation. I hope you are crying out for this next generation. This next generation, just like every generation before, the enemy is trying to sift them like wheat. He's trying to eliminate the foundation of God that our nation was built upon, and it will be their future success. I see this in almost every stratum of life. And it breaks my heart. It breaks my heart that before I let my kids watch a new cartoon, I have to look it up now. Say, what's in this thing? What kind of lies are they going to try to put in front of my kids' eyes so that I can prepare them, or so I can wash their brains, or so I can not let them have it at all? Did you ever think we'd be here? Do you ever think we'd be here with media? There are entire shows that are just pornographic now being communicated to our kids as really good dramas. The twistedness that is targeted, the way innocence is being ripped from our children, this world no longer cares about our kids' innocence. And if you're a parent of a young child, you know the battle that this is. I want my kid to enjoy things. I want them to be able to relate to people around them. But if I open this door, what does it allow my kid to see, to understand? What am I exposing them to? We need to walk with great wisdom as parents, amen? But as a church, what can we do? So I want that to kind of be in your mind, because we're going to go over this a little bit more. But if you have your Bibles, I'd love you to turn to the book, 1 John. 1 John, chapter 2. Believe it or not, this is the very first passage I ever preached when I was interviewing to be a youth pastor in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, where I was a youth pastor for 6 years. This right here, the title of that message, oh my goodness, how many years ago was that? 18 years ago, the title of my message was 40-Year-Old Baby. You'll see why here in a second. Not the title of my message today, but this passage is near and dear to my heart. And every time I begin to think about the next generation, I come back to this passage, because there's a secret in this passage that should motivate us as a church and should tell us what kind of environment we have to create for our young people to succeed. All right, here we go. 1 John chapter 2, starting in verse 12. He says, I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. And I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. First thing we need to note, three different groups right here. The three different groups are children. Everybody say children. Now this is talking about spiritual ages, okay? Did you know your physical outside does not mean anything when it comes to your spiritual inside? You can have an 18-year-old that is so mature in their faith because of what they walk through with Christ. And you can have a 50-year-old that's a brand new baby Christian. Some of you in here may be adult newborns. Any adult newborns in here? You were an adult when you first got saved? Everybody was saved at a young age. Anybody here saved at a later age? It's amazing. An adult newborn is someone that they're an adult physically, but all of a sudden they come to the new knowledge of Jesus Christ and they're born again, the Bible says. And then you get to grow spiritually. This is really talking about spiritual growth, but it has a lot to do with how we help our kids grow. Because it says here that children know that their sins are forgiven. That's Christianity Basics 101. We have sinned. We have fallen short of the glory of God. So God had a plan. And he sent his son, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, who died on a cross. 3 days later, he rose again. And because of his shed blood and because of his victory over death, hell, and the grave, we can now walk in forgiveness. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is the first thing that a child or a newborn in the faith will understand, that I can be forgiven. Do you know that you can be forgiven today? Do you know forgiveness is your today? If you have stepped into that and you have put your faith in Jesus Christ, then you are now at least a child in the kingdom of God. Now, I don't disparage children for being children. Matter of fact, on Sunday nights, we have prayer night, and I've called it a family prayer night, and sometimes we have kids that act like children. Can you believe it? Is it okay if a child acts like a child? Within reason. It's cute within reason. Now, anybody like it when an adult acts like a child? That's a bit different. That's my original title 18 years ago, 40-year-old babies. You know, it's not cute to be 40-year-old and act like a baby, right? Children understand this idea that they're forgiven. But then it talks about this other group, fathers. Okay, we just had Father's Day. I remember a time when I was a son, and then I became a son and a husband, and then I became a son, a husband, and a father. Do you know what makes someone a father in the spirit? It says here that fathers know Him who is from the beginning. They know Him who's from the beginning. They know God so well, they've been able to lead somebody else to Him. There has been fruit in the kingdom of God because of your walk. So if you're wondering, am I a father spiritually yet? My challenge to you is this. Have you brought people to the one that you know so well? Have you fallen in love with Jesus so much? Have you got to know God so much that it's natural for you to want to bring the lost to Him? That is what creates a father in the kingdom of heaven. Just like humanity, I became a father when I reproduced, and all of a sudden I had this thing. He was little and terrifying and amazing. You know, same thing happens in the kingdom of God. When people begin to come in and you become a father, there's this almost sense of responsibility. Oh man, I invited you. I talked to you about Christ. Now I want to help you grow. Fathers understand that responsibility. So the spiritual fathers know Him. He was from the beginning. But then there's this other group, and this is the group I kind of am talking about today, is young men. Now, this can be young women. It means youth. It means young person. Now, again, we all know what a young person is physically, but what is a young person spiritually? Well, the identifier of a young person is that they are overcoming. Can you say overcoming? So I want you to picture this. If there was a 2-year-old here, and this 2-year-old was hungry, would I give the 2-year-old my keys and say, go get yourself food? Anybody? No. That'd be ridiculous, right? However, one of my kids happened to turn 16 recently. Happy belated birthday. At camp every year, it's been his birthday since he's been like forever. I think you've been at camp. You were 3 days old when we first went to camp. If you remember that, that was exciting. You probably don't remember that. I do. He was this big. Now at 16, I'm hungry, Dad. Great. Solve the problem yourself, son. I'm going to give you what you need. Here's the keys. Here's $5. Well, I guess $10 now. Go take care of the problem. He can overcome his own problem. Why? Because he's been trained, he's been equipped, and he's grown to the point that he can now overcome. Does this make sense? This is what an overcomer looks like. Now, back to 1 John chapter 2. Because in a strange way, John repeats himself. But in the repeat, we learn something very important for our purposes today. Continuing reading in the second part of verse 13, it says, I write to you, little children, because you have known the Father. And I have written to you, fathers, because you have known Him who is from the beginning. Then he says, and I have written to you, young men, because you are strong. And the word of God abides, that means lives in you, and you've overcome the wicked one. Again, we see these three groups. We see that children not only understand that they are saved, but they understand that God is their father. That's something that a child quickly understands. Matter of fact, I win 3 out of 4 kids said dad before mom. Sorry, Bree. 3 of 4 of my kids identified dad. All 4 of them identified mom and dad very quickly in life. A child in Christ, a newborn, quickly will begin to identify God as their father. And that's a beautiful thing. Again, then we see fathers. What do? They know Him. You know, I learned there's a huge difference between knowing about God and knowing God. Anybody else discover that? We can know a lot about God, but you see, fathers know. They don't just know about Him. It's not just facts and figures and dreams. No, it's actual experiential understanding of who God is. They know Him who is from the beginning. Then it says, I've written to you young men. Because you're strong. I mean, you know, the Bible says the glory of the youth is their strength. Anybody else enjoy that interesting time in your life where you can make your kids do manual labor and they do it well? If you have little kids, you're not there yet. If you have little kids, having your kids help you in the yard is extra work. And you know that. I'm going to have to stop. I'm going to have to pick up the thing. He's going to drop nails everywhere, so I got to go buy the magnet, okay? Right? But all of a sudden, there's this weird age. I never forget with my oldest son, I bought a deep freezer. And I had somebody deliver it to the garage. And I called my father, hey, will you come help me get this deep freezer in the basement? And my son's in the garage, and we're just waiting. And he says, Dad, I can lift that. I'm like, aw, no you can't. Dad, I can lift that. Again, I'm just like, aw. He walks up to the deep freezer, bends over, and lifts half of it. Looks at me and says, Dad, I can lift this. I haven't plowed my driveway in years. Why? Because he can lift it. All of a sudden, he crossed that age where he wasn't just a child. Now he was like strong. He was useful. His mind became to a point where we could have conversation and he could understand. And it was like, wow, he can do a job with excellence. This is awesome. Love it. Young men are strong, but not talking about physical strength. It says, because the word of God abides or lives in them. That is what turns a child in the faith into a young person that overcomes in the faith. The word of God abides in them. And because of that, then they overcome the wicked one. Keep reading, because now John's going to tell us what we need to teach our children so they become young men so they can get to the fatherhood stage. Verse 15 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. How many of you know that this world is very shiny? The world presents an attractive facade, which is the same thing I do in mouse traps. I put something very shiny and yummy to a mouse on the trap, and I set it down, and I just wait. Enjoy that cheese, buddy. That's what the world does. And here it's warning us, hey, if we're going to have people grow and mature, we have to be aware that this world is going to try to convince our kids to love it. The number one lie in the young person's heart that can only be revealed by God, by the way. We can say it till we're blue in the face. But any of you who have been around and you've walked this walk with Christ for any amount of time, you'll agree with this statement. The world has nothing for you. If you agree with that, say amen. Amen. I'm going to say it one more time. The world has nothing for you. But now I want you to think back to when you were 17 and knew it all. Did you really believe that? Did you really believe that the world had nothing for you? Because it kind of looks fun. There's kind of a lot of things I could do. Only to find out that the fun doesn't last, that the things break down, and the joy the world offers comes with barbs and hooks and prices you did not know about. Sometimes it takes a while for someone to come to that revelation, and often that path looks like a lot of drama and pain. Anybody have to go the drama pain path? I've watched it happen. It's like, why go the drama and pain path? I was spared from the drama pain path when I watched my loved ones walk through it. Part of the reason I think I was spared from it. I never had to really go down the drama and pain path as deep as many, many others. And I'm grateful for God's mercy in my life. But our young people need to be convinced that this world has nothing to offer them. That every good gift comes from the Father of light, and in him there is no shadow of turning. Are you with me? Our kids need to understand that the fullness of joy is not found with a big bank account or with this success or with this degree, but joy is found at the right hand of God the Father. Our kids need to be taught the truth about why they were created. They weren't created to do whatever they wanted to do. They weren't created so they could just go about. They were created for a purpose designed by God to fulfill a place in his kingdom, because people are lost and dying and going to hell, and my children need to know who they are so they can find their place in the body, so the body will be more effective at reaching the lost. Do you see that? And where are they ever going to hear that message? I'm telling you, it's not on Netflix. It says here, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lusts of the flesh, fleshly desires, the lusts of the eyes, things that are appealing, and the pride of life. Oh, pride. Pride keeps people trapped in sin. Remember that message from a couple weeks ago? Pride keeps people trapped in their sin. Pride will keep a young person from acknowledging the lusts that are in them that they need to overcome. Matter of fact, Timothy is encouraged to flee youthful lusts. But guess what? Children who grow up to become overcomers, they begin to overcome youthful lusts. How many know there's lots of lust in this world? Lust for money, lust for sex, lust for power, lust for popularity. And all those things can be overcome by a revelation of who God is. I'm telling you, if there's a struggle in your life that you're not overcoming, there's something about God you don't yet know. There's an aspect of his character and of his nature and of his heart that he so wants to reveal to you. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, it is not of the Father, but is of the world. And this world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Again, young people, if you can hear my voice, this world has nothing to offer you. Every bit of fun that is found outside of God's righteousness is a lie. It's a trick. It's a lie. People are not as happy as Facebook makes them out to be. People are not as happy as they appear to be on Instagram. If it were true, then every Hollywood star would be completely content. Why? They have money, fame, popularity. Is that what you need to be happy? Says this world. Yet how many of them are miserable? How many of them find themselves addicted to drugs and doing all kinds of other things? And why? Because they're not actually content. True contentment is only found when you discover what God made you to be, and you do that with all your heart. True contentment is only found when you look at the world and say, eh, you can't offer me anything. Why? Because he's already given me everything. This has to be a consistent message within the church. The church cannot squirrel around on some of these issues. When our young people are coming to us, hey, I heard this. We as a church need to have an answer. We need to be able to show them from the word of God the end of their ways. Why? Because the glory of the youth is their strength, but the glory of the old is their wisdom. And wisdom understands the ends of their ways. So, church question for you. Put your thinking caps on. How do we do this? How do we help our kids and youth become overcomers? Now hear me, it starts in the home. 100% starts in the home. I don't ever want us to think that the church is a replacement for godly parenting. However, I believe the church can be a major boost and an encouragement as we come alongside parents and minister to kids. But here's a sad fact. There are kids in our community that don't have godly parents and family. Is there any hope for them? Do we just write them off and say, lost? Or do we as a church open our eyes and say, wow, how can we help? What do we need to do? How do we actually help our kids and youth become actual, real life overcomers? I'm telling you, it's going to be when we as a church become intentional in our thinking. We become intentional in our living. We become intentional with our time and our resources, and we open our eyes beyond our slice of pain and our slice of work and our slice of drama. And we say, Lord, what are you wanting us to do in this community? What are you wanting us to do? Again, 2 weeks ago, we sent kids to camp. Anybody know Tony? He's actually down in the kids' church today. You know Tony? Sometimes in the back, Kraft. You should just talk to Tony. He went as our adult counselor for our preteen group. These are kids 9 to 12 years old. I'd love you to hear his story about what happened at camp. Because you know what he came away from camp saying? Pastor, these kids, 9 to 12-year-olds, were worshiping God with all their heart. They were receiving from the Holy Spirit things that I didn't even know kids could receive. Pastor, did you know last night the 9 to 12-year-olds spent an hour praying for each other? He sent me some pictures from his phone of 9 to 12-year-olds surrounding their friends in prayer. 9 to 12-year-olds on their knees weeping. 9 to 12-year-olds ministering one to another. 9 to 12-year-olds full of the Holy Spirit of God. And he said, I finally get what you're talking about. He said, oh, if we can create that kind of environment for our kids. If they can encounter the power of God in a real way at that age, what lie of the world is going to pull them away? Guys, at camp, there were young people that had no interest in God. In fact, one of the young people that came with us told me on Tuesday I had no spiritual thoughts at all. But that week, he rededicated his life to the Lord. That week, he encountered a refreshing. And since then, I just met with him last week. He says, I hope it's okay, but I've only been reading one chapter a day. It's about all I can handle. I'm like, yeah, I guess you can get away with that. No, I was celebrating like, man, a young man choosing to open up the Word of God. That is fruit in his life. Why? Because I know that if he's going to grow from being a child to being a young man that's overcoming, the Word of God is going to be key. Would you agree? And I have to say, church culture, sometimes there's this lie. If I go to church on Sunday morning, it's enough. Guys, this is not enough for anybody. I love meeting with you. Don't get me wrong. I actually really enjoy preaching. I love preparing messages. But you know, the president of my Bible college warned us every single semester. I got really annoyed at it because I didn't think it was true until I realized he's right. I was a teenager then. It's okay. He said, your prep time for your message does not replace your pursuit of Jesus Christ. He says, don't you get caught up in this lie. More pastors and ministers burn out because they spend all of their time prepping for others and they forget to love the one who is their strength, their joy, and their foundation. He would say this all the time. Like, that makes no sense. And he even challenged us students. He said, you know, right here at Bible College is the best place for you to backslide. He says, because you're going to be studying the Word of God hours and hours every week and you're going to be thinking that's your time with God. If you're not finding time to pursue your love relationship with God outside of your studies, you're going to grow cold. He was right. I watched student after student drop out and even almost walk away from faith. Why? Because they got so caught up in the busyness and the intellectual study, they forgot the reality. And the real thing was to know Him who was from the beginning. How do we help our kids be overcomers? What can we do as a church? Can we make them do it? Shock colors, right? Right? This would be great. You have a bad thought, shock. Wait, no, that's not right. Ooh, I know really good advertisements. We'll convince them. Oh, no, that doesn't work either. Guys, what can we actually do? Yeah, I'm leading you somewhere. You're figuring that out. Like, I'm not saying nothing. He has a way. I do have an answer. Here's what we can do. Are you ready? We can create an environment for our kids. We can create an environment in our own homes, but also right here at church, we create an environment. An environment to do what? An environment where every generation will understand the goodness of God. Because Cross Point Church, hear me, this is my dream. This is one of the calls of God on my life. One of the reasons He brought me here. Because Cross Point Church will be a multi-generational church. We will be. It's where we're going. It's a church that sees everyone, grandparents to grandkids. It creates an environment for all of them to experience the love of God. Because there has to be a place, adults, where we receive ministry and encouragement. Would you agree? But there also has to be a place where now that I've received ministry encouragement, that I pour out and minister to others. It's the balance. So when I say multi-generational church, I am dreaming of a marriage ministry. And I'm like, Lord, who's going to lead our marriage ministry? Who's going to lead our seniors ministry? Father, this church needs a vibrant men's ministry and vibrant women's ministry. Lord, who are you going to raise up to lead these things? Give me eyes to see, because the truth is I'm very limited in my capacities. I can do like two things really well. Okay, one and a half, if you ask my wife. Right? Like, I believe that what God's going to begin to do is God's going to begin to reveal his calling and his purpose in us as a body more than ever before. And you're going to find yourself thinking of things like, hey, I could put something together, and it'll be the weirdest thought. I could do something for college kids. College kids, oh, gross, college, no, but I could do this. You're going to be walking around town, you're going to be noticing a certain age group or people group and be like, hey, I wonder how we can minister to them. Okay, that's a weird thought. I've never thought that before. No, God's going to begin to awaken us as a church to callings that he has placed in you from long ago. Matter of fact, I dream of seeing small groups develop, life groups. Why? Because relationships matter. Now, are we there yet? No, we're not there yet, but I want to get there. This is the dream. This is the dream. But for today, we're going to start with our kids. Where do we start? You can start a lot of places. I believe that we must start with our kids. Matter of fact, after church today, there's a kids ministry meeting for anybody who feels called to kids ministry. Can you go to that next slide for me? We're going to start with our kids. There's this kids ministry meeting today for anybody who's interested in nursery, which is typically 0 to 2. Preschool, which is 3 to 5. And then kids ministry, which is 6 to 8, somewhere in there. If you're interested in being a part of helping create an environment for those ages of kids, there's a meeting right after church downstairs. Hopefully there's enough food for everybody. We'll have lunch. We're going to talk about some things. We're going to cast some vision. We're going to talk about policies and procedures. What a weird thing. Why? Because to create an environment, you need to be in unity with one another, right? To create an environment, it takes a lot. Now, we've had amazing kids ministry here. But I believe God's going to be expanding our influence circle. And we are preparing for what's coming. We're building the barn, and we're going to get ready for God to fill it. So that's what this kids ministry meeting is after church. Why? Because when kids come together, we as a church, again, we can't make them fall in love with Jesus. We can't make them behave, but here's what we can do. We can create an environment where our kids can discover the God of the Bible. We can tell them Bible stories and sing them Bible songs. We can have them understand the character and the nature of God. That by the time they reach that 6, 7, 8-year-old age, they are convinced that there is a God in heaven who created the earth. And he is the God described in the Bible, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and Jacob. Jesus Christ is his son. They will believe it. Why? Because we created this environment with intentionality. With intentionality. To develop in them this understanding, this knowing, this belief. And that's the whole vision of kids ministry. And all of these ages, this is what we do. We make an environment for them. Now, everybody ever heard the Texas phrase, you can bring a horse to water, you can't make him drink? All right? You can bring someone to a Packer game, but you can't make him cheer if they're Bears fans. I don't know if that works. All we do, our job is the environment. God does the rest. God does the rest, all right? Now, soon and coming, we're going to be having a preteen ministry. What is the preteen ministry? Preteens are ages 9 to 12. It's that pre-teenage years. Why 9 to 12? Well, really, this is where kids start puberty. We understand this. This is right now the target of our culture. Our culture is targeting 9 to 12-year-olds in this vulnerable season where they are changing physically from children to adults, where they're already confused about their feelings and their emotions, and this world is trying to convince them of all these other identities in this phase of change. If you don't know it, just look at the media that they promote to that age group. It's not being hidden anymore what our world wants from that age group. They want them in their awkwardness to make declarations over who they are other than I am a child of God. This world wants that age group to start identifying with anything other than Jesus Christ. So here's the dream of a preteen ministry. Here's what I'd love to see. I'd love to see on Sunday morning a preteen team so that our preteens join us in worship. Why? Because preteens are not kids, neither are they adults, so we want them to come and enjoy worship with the congregation. But then I'd love to be able to dismiss our preteens to a classroom where they can then study the Word of God on a level that is understandable to them. They can have discussions and talk about it. Because I think oftentimes the Sunday message might not be targeted at preteens and what they're walking through. But what if there was a team of adults who'd surround those preteens and walk them through some understandings of who God is? Would help them hear me. This is the environment we want to create. Would create an environment where our preteens encounter the power of God in a personal way. So after they've gone through kids' church, they believe in the God of the Bible. Awesome. Believing is the first step. Right? And he who comes to God must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of them who seek him. Now that they're getting older, and that 9 to 12-year-old age, their minds are becoming open. They're able to make more decisions and come to different conclusions. And in that time, I want them to encounter the power of the blood of Jesus. And I want them to give their heart to him. I want them to encounter the power of the Holy Spirit and learn how to pray. I want them to encounter the power of the Word of God and experience God speaking to them from his Word. Preteens? Absolutely. They're not too young. And as I tell every preteen, there's no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit. Amen. Can you see that? But that's an environment, man. That's intentional. That takes time. You talk about prayer. We got to pray. We got to build a hedge around them. We got to surround those kids in prayer. We have to cry out for the anointing of God. I'd love to start with Sunday mornings at the preteens. Eventually, I'd love to see either midweek or Sunday evening preteen group that would meet. Why? Because the preteens could build greater fellowship with one another. They could dive in even deeper. I want to get the Word of God in them. I want to create an environment for them to encounter the power of God in a personal way. And then for our youth. By the way, if you don't know this, youth small group starts tonight. It's way too quiet in here. Let me say that again. Youth small group starts tonight. Why? Because we took 14 kids to camp, and I believe we have a responsibility now as a church. So tonight we're starting. We've already been having Sunday night prayer, family prayer. I do encourage you. If you've never come to our Sunday night prayer, come on out. Bring your kids. It's family friendly. We come, we pray from 6:30 to 7:30. It's an opportunity. Now, do all of my kids love an hour of prayer? No. But you know what? The hour of being quiet before the Lord has produced fruit in my family's life. The conversations, being around other people, hearing people praying. Our kids need to be in that kind of environment, I believe. So I want to encourage you, if you haven't made it part of your schedule, 6:30 to 7:30, right here. But what's going to happen, we're going to be opening up with a couple songs of worship, and then we're going to be dismissing our youth, which is grade 7 to 12. And they're going to start a small group. Why? Because it's going to be the beginning of a youth group. Why did I call it a youth group? Because it's a small group. Small groups are ran a little bit differently. But that's okay. That's where we're going to start. And my hope and my prayer is that we're going to create an environment where our youth discover their identity in Christ. Because here's the truth. If you can truly ground a young person with the Christ, with Jesus as their identity, then no trick this world throws at them is ever going to work. They're going to go off to college. They're going to hear all this stuff. And they're going to be like, no, a child of God doesn't do that. A child of God doesn't think that way. That's not how a child of God would act. I'm going to make my decisions based on my identity, not based on my feelings. I'm going to make my decisions based on my identity, not based on peer pressure around me. Guys, this works. How do I know that this works? Camp. Go back to camp nightly, 3 days old at camp, our very first year as youth pastors, 16 years ago. I brought 9 kids from Eau Claire, Wisconsin to this camp, and I was so excited. I was so pumped. I was the new youth pastor at Tabernacle of Praise was the name of the church back then. 9 kids came. Oh, I couldn't believe it. First time taking kids to camp. I was terrified. I had such amazing experiences at camps growing up, and I so wanted that for them. And God did not disappoint. The Spirit of God was moving. But all week long, I had one young man who did this every service. Worship's going on. Kids are jumping. They're praising God. This is him. Ever just really want to hit a kid? But you know you shouldn't. Every night, amazing messages. I know what's going on in his life. I'm like, it's for you, it's for you. Does this. Until the last night. There was a shift in his posture during the ministry that was happening the last night. And the young man went from arms crossed to this. And that's all it took. That young man cried at the altar for the next hour and a half. Gave his heart to the Lord, was filled with the Holy Spirit. Came back completely changed. He became one of just a young man that loved the Lord. Loved the Lord all the way through youth ministry until he went to high school. Until he went to college. I apologize. And we moved on. We moved and became family pastors at a different church during that time. And because of Facebook, we got to stay in contact with a lot of these kids. And through Facebook, we got to watch a life that one time hailed Jesus as King to a life that you wouldn't know loved Jesus at all. And it's so sad in my heart to see this particular young man walk away from his passionate faith, just to live the blasé life of the world. Fast forward many, many, many years to this year at camp. I go early. I'm getting ready for the first counselor meeting, and there on the table is all the counselor folders with pictures of the counselors and all their details. And one of the counselors coming to camp this year was that young man. But as an adult, it was weird. He should be 16, not 32. As an adult, not only that, he is now the youth pastor at that church. Church gone through two name changes. But he's now the youth pastor at that church where I first started, and he is leading his first group of youth to camp. And I talked to him. I said, man, tell me, what happened? He says, every time, that entire years that I wasted, I walked away from the Lord, he says, I never forgot what God did. I never forgot what God did at this camp. I never forgot really who I was. It followed me around everywhere. Just see that picture. Picture that. Why? Because he actually knew who he was in Christ. He just wasn't living it. He wasn't walking it. He says, at any time I could have turned around. At any time I could have repented, and I just didn't. And I didn't, and I didn't, until I did. You see, when we create an environment for young people to discover their identity in Christ, it is a lifelong truth that will follow them. And that's why the Bible says when you train up a child and they are young, when they're old, they'll not depart from it, because that identity, that truth follows them everywhere. So in conclusion this morning, this is a new season for our church. And my challenge, my encouragement is, let's step into the plan of God and truly become a multi-generational church. So what's the ask, Pastor? That's a great idea. What do you want from me? I want each of us just to, in our own time in the next couple of weeks, to say, God, where do you want me to receive ministry? Maybe we need a small group. Maybe we need a Bible study. Maybe we need a men's breakfast more than once a month. Maybe we need, I don't know, where do I need to receive ministry? And then the second question is, and where am I being called to minister? Where am I being called to be a part? I'm putting out a call today for youth and preteens. It's not the only ministries that people are called to, hear me. It's just the current ministries we're trying to build. I'm putting out a call today for our kids' ministry. I can help create this environment for kids to discover the God of the Bible. I want to be on a team. The call is out there. And I believe that there is ample people to respond. Well, guys, we're a small church. We don't have thousands of people. But you don't need thousands. Because, you know, statistically, less than 15% of a church participates in the ministries of the church. I used to say, you know, the 80-20 rule. It's more like the 85-15 rule now. But what if a church our size wakes up and says, I'm called to something. What does it look like? What if we had 90% participation? Okay, I know some of you are like, you're dreaming. Yes, I'm dreaming. For a church of 80 to 100 people to have 90% participation, we would have the volunteer and the labor force of a church of 700. Math is fun. It can be done. It's not impossible. Is it hard? Yes. Is it difficult? Sure. Is it worth it? Oh my goodness. So much. Well, my wife and I saw that picture and that young man. She took a picture of it on her phone and she sent it to me and she's coming to me crying and then I was crying and we're like, it's worth it. The time, the energy, the effort. Sometimes you wonder, is it even worth it, God? It's worth it. Why? Because God followed him. The seeds that were planted did not die. He said at any moment he could turn and repent. And I believe we can create that kind of environment too. I believe we can create an environment for our adults to fall more in love with Jesus, to know him who's from the beginning, to begin to lead people into the kingdom of God. I believe we create an environment for our marriages to be Christ-centered, where husbands love their wives as Christ loved the church, where wives respect and honor their husbands, and where the kingdom of heaven is present in every home. I believe we can create an environment for our college kids to discover their place in the body of Christ. I could just keep going. The dream is to truly be multi-generational. We have to get there. So for today, we're starting with the kids. We're not going to stop there. We're going to keep going. So that's the challenge. It's heavy, it's scary, but it's awesome. I've been around the block long enough to know it is worth it, and it can be done. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you. Lord, I thank you for Cross Point Church. I thank you that you strategically located us in the middle of a booming neighborhood. Lord, there is more adults and young people within 4 miles of this church than this church could handle if we did 6 services a week. Lord, it's not about the lost and their lack of numbers, because as you said, the harvest is truly great. So God, our cry, my cry today is, oh God, Lord of the harvest, send laborers. Send laborers into the harvest. Send laborers into the harvest of kids' ministry. Into the harvest of preteen ministry. Send laborers, oh God. Send laborers to the harvest of youth ministry. Father, send laborers for the harvest of young adult ministry. May St. Norbert's experience a revival. May the young people going there call upon the name of the Lord and be saved, oh God. Oh God, send laborers to our marriages, to the marriages of this community. Father, send laborers to the empty nesters. Send laborers to grandparents. Send laborers to men. Send laborers to women. Oh God, there is such a need. Send laborers to the multiple of generations you are calling us to be a voice to. And God, give us wisdom. Give us wisdom as we pursue this, as we stand. And Father, I especially pray over those young people that went to camp. Continue to do that which you began in them. Continue that which you began in them, oh God. May we be good stewards of it. I pray this in Jesus' name. If you agree with that, would you say amen? I am super excited because I have seen God do amazing things, and I'm just looking forward to what he's going to do right here at Cross Point Church. It's going to be fun. So with that, I do have a couple of closing announcements. First announcement, I mentioned it in the service. I want to say it again. Kids Church Ministry Meeting. And when we dismiss, within about 10 or 15 minutes, let's try to be downstairs so we can have a meeting. There is food. And we'll try to be quick, but at the same time, the meeting will last about 45 minutes. We want to get you information and continue to expand our understanding of how we can do this better, of how we can create this environment for our kids. Okay? So that's directly after church. Coming up again tonight, there is family prayer night, but also the first youth small group. Again, if any of your kids are going into the 7th grade all the way through the 12th grade, even if they graduated this year through the summer, they're welcome to join the youth. First youth small group. The youth are going to start meeting. They're going to start encouraging one another, ironing, sharpening iron, growing in the love of Christ, and hopefully creating this environment where they discover their identity in Christ. That's going to happen. And I want you to mark your calendars. We have a church picnic planned. What's the date? Oh, there it is, July 7th. On July 7th, I know it's July 4th weekend. I pulled a lot of people. Most people are back. That's a Sunday night. We're going to do it from 5:30 to, wait, I'm looking at you. Hold on. 5 to 7. I don't have my notes in front of me. 5 to 7 o'clock. The whole point is we're going to get together as a church. It's going to be potluck style. Church is going to provide burgers and brats, and we hope everybody brings something. There will be family games and activities. So I hope you come and enjoy it. And so save the date, July 7th. So that'll be in the evening. So instead of our family prayer and youth small group, we will meet in the park together. Is that something you plan? Awesome. With that, I would like you all to stand. I'd like you to greet your neighbor. Say good morning. Good to see you. I'm glad you're here. Let's go grab coffee, ice cream. Get to know one another. And with that, may the Lord bless you, keep you, and protect you. You are dismissed.
Well, when the healing physicians don't know what to do, the great physicians.